Then we have the second A of the IAAA model, that is authorization. This is where we determine now that this person has logged in, they have proven who they are, what do we give them access to? And depending on the type of organization we're in, we can choose different types of access control models. The most common types and the ones that you may see on the exam is DAC, Discretionary Access Control, MAC, Mandatory Access Control, RBAC, Role-Based Access Control, and then finally ABAC, Attribute-Based Access Control. Now, if you are in the private sector, it is very likely that your organization uses RBAC, Role-Based Access Control. That's the one where if you are a network administrator or a security administrator, you get certain rights assigned to you, and every other network or security administrator have the same rights. The rights assigned are based on your role. Now, role-based access control also comes with a need to know, and we have talked about this one before. That's the one where you are allowed to access the data if you have a need to know. If your work requires you to access that data to do your job, you can access the data. If it does not, you're not allowed to. And we do this because in most organizations, it's much easier to give you way more rights than you need instead of having to assign you new rights every time you need to work on something else. This was the example where I talked about the doctor. The doctor has access to every single patient file in the entire hospital because if there's an emergency, we don't have time to grant him access to see that specific patient's records. They have access to everything, but they're only allowed to access the records of the patients they're actively treating. Next up, we have DAC, or Discretionary Access Control. And that's what you use when you have a Windows system or a Linux. You, as the owner of an object, can grant certain rights or permissions to others based on your discretion, hence the name. If I have a folder on my computer that I want to share with my team, well then I can share that with the team and I can give them certain rights. Maybe my manager needs access rights to manage the entire folder. They need to be able to delete objects, add objects, and the rest of the team only need to be able to read the files. Well, then I set those permissions up so the security administrators have read rights, whereas my manager has read, write, and delete. Next up, we have MAC, or Mandatory Access Control, and that's very heavily used in the intelligence services and in the military. And we use this in places where the confidentiality leg of the CIA triad is most important. And with MAC, we use least privilege. That's the one where we give people as little as possible access to do their day-to-day jobs, and if they need to do anything outside of that, we need to grant them more rights. Which makes sense, right? This is a highly secure environment. We give them exactly enough access, no more, no less. Then we have RBAC, or Role-Based Access Control. We talked about this one already. Network administrators get network administrator rights. Security administrators get security administrator rights. By far, the type of access control that is most commonly used, and it makes the administration of thousands of users and tens of thousands of permissions much easier to manage. If you look at the image over here on the right, you can see that IT security has an IT role. It has a general role. It has a finance role. We would have specific IT security roles. So all of those privileges are assigned to the IT security role, and anyone joining that team just gets assigned those rights. One of the important things with RBAC is we need to remember whenever someone moves from one department to another, they need to have their old rights removed and the new ones added. If we just add new rights every time, after 5 or 10 years, they can have a tremendous amount of rights and they can do a lot of damage. We need to have that separation of duties. We can't have the same person that issued the purchase order sign the checks, because then there's no one checking on them. Next up, we have something that's more new. That is attribute-based access control. And it really is something that builds on top of role-based. Here, we grant access to objects based on the object, the subject, and environmental conditions. The subject could be the user, the object is whatever I need access to, and then something in the environment. And what that means is if I am a project manager, then I inherently wouldn't have access to the data center. Only the data center team would. But if I get assigned a project for the data center team in the data center, I have that attribute. I now have access to the data center. And compared to the other types of access control, this is relatively new. But it is expected that about 70% of large enterprises will implement this within the next 5 years, whereas today it's maybe 25%. And you can also hear it referred to as policy-based access control, PBAC, or claims-based access control, CBAC. In most places, though, you will see ABAC, attribute-based access control. As the last part of authorization, let's look at context and content-based access control. So context, you can get access based on certain contextual parameters. That can be your location, your time, sequence of responses, or access history. So if I log in from my PC at home, that IP is whitelisted, meaning I'm allowed to do that within working hours, well then I would get access to the corporate network. But if I log in at 3 in the morning, which is outside of my working hours, from an IP in an entirely different country, I would not get access. My access is granted based on a context. And then we have content-based access control. Here, as the name indicates, access is based on the content of an object. And what that really means is, depending on who you are and your rights, you will be shown certain content. If a doctor logs into a system, he will be shown one set of data. If a physical therapist logs in, they see something else. If it's a pharmacist that logs in, they will see something else. So it really just is hiding views, hiding data, showing data, depending on the attributes and the content of the object. And then finally, we have accountability. That may also at times be referred to as auditing. This is where we trace the actions of a subject, that could be you, to your identity. If I log in from my workstation using my IP during work hours on a day where I worked, it's going to be hard for me to refute that I changed that data. I mean, there are loopholes. There are things that can happen, but it is highly likely that I did it, and that then gives us non-repudiation. And if we break that down to repudiate something, it's to say something is not true. Non-repudiation, you can't say it's not true. Because again, I used my PC, my username and password, my token, my IP, in my work hours, it is very likely I did it. And while I do understand that users share passwords, hey, let me log into your account and see something real quick. By now, you also know that we give them the training, so we raise their awareness, so they know not just let someone borrow their account, because they are liable, they are accountable. And just like we don't share our login information with our colleagues or anyone else, we don't use group logins or group passwords. Because if we do that, there is no accountability. If 20 people have that username and password, then how do we know who changed the file and broke everything? And then finally, I think we need to talk about subjects and objects. This is something we're going to keep going back to throughout this course. A subject is active. It's most often users like you and me, but it can also be a program. Subjects manipulate objects. Objects have labels and subjects have clearance. And for the subject to access the object, the clearance needs to supersede the label. But there are some things that can both be subjects and objects, but not at the same time. This could be a program. A program can both be a subject and an object, meaning when it accesses the data somewhere else, it is the subject. But if something else pulls the data from that program, well, then it is the object. And then the objects, they are passive, and that's really any data. It can be data on a piece of paper or data on a server. Objects are manipulated by subjects. And with that, we are done with this lecture. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next one.